This Sunday and next Sunday also, I want to share with you, teach you about one of the most important tools that God has given us. Okay, such a powerful tool that God has given us that we can use to bring about supernatural transformation. And I use those words purposely. I can promise you that if you learn what I'm about to share with you, because I've been doing this for over 30 years of my life, and it results in supernatural transformation. This tool is a God-given strategy, a God-given resource that you can use to change the spiritual atmosphere in your home, in your neighborhood, in your school, in your workplace. And next week we're going to talk about lots of examples, okay? But it's also it's a tool to help you use or exercise your spiritual authority in the realms that God's given you, that God's called you to. It's a force that you can use to pull down strongholds wherever you go, and it's a weapon that you can use to overcome your spiritual enemies and help set your loved ones free. Like, this is powerful. We just don't understand it. See, the problem is that most of the time, when you talk to someone about prayer walking, and you say, what is that? They go, praying while walking? And you go, well, yes, but it's really so much more than that. So much more than that. And as we begin to understand the reality of what prayer walking is, we're going to use it wherever we go. We're going to use prayer walking not only next Friday, but we're going to use prayer walking in our home, on our street, in our schools, in our place of employment, in our hospitals, in our malls, wherever you go. When you're driving in your car, I do prayer driving too. When I drive around a certain area. So I want to start by looking at the biblical foundations and four key ones, biblical foundations for prayer walking. The first one is called the foundation of inspired revelation. I didn't know what to call it, so I call it this. The foundation of inspired revelation out of Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. The man, that's Adam, and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Now, to set this up, this is the day after Adam and Eve had sinned and eaten of the fruit that they were told not to eat of, and they eaten instead of the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And God came walking in the garden looking for Adam and Eve, right? God came walking in the garden looking for Adam and Eve. Why did he come doing that? Well, because that was his regular habit. You know, it's because that was their daily routine, that every day it would seem God and Adam and Eve walked together in the Garden of Eden, and they talked together, they fellowshiped together, and as they discussed things together and shared together, they communicated together, and they received revelation from God. Remember that Adam and Eve were born perfect, but they were not born mature. They grew in maturity as they related to the Father. And so God was giving them revelation. And that's one of the things that prayer walking is all about. Prayer walking is about talking with God, not just walking, but talking with God while walking, listening to what he says, sharing our hearts with him, developing intimacy with him, speaking with him, listening to him, and learning what he wants us to understand. As you're walking down your neighborhood, God, what do you want me to understand about that home there where all those loud parties are? What should I pray for that home rather than those dirty, rotten sinners, you know? Like, what, God, do you want me to pray for in that home? Is there a marriage issue you want me to pray for? Maybe the person, maybe there's illness in the home, right? So as you're prayer walking, you're saying, Lord, what do you want me to know about my street? What do you want me to know about my place of work? How do you want me to pray? So one of the foundations of prayer walking is the foundation of inspired revelation, just that as we walk along, we talk to God and we listen to what God's saying, and we hear what he wants to tell us about the place we're walking. Okay? It's not about just coming with a script and walking house number one, bless them. House number two, bless them. House number three, bless them. No, or house number one, curse them. House number, you know, that's not what it's about. It's about, God, what do you want me to know about this home? What do you want me to know about that store in the mall? What do you want me to know about that desk in the workplace? What do you want me to know about that room in my school? Okay? Inspired revelation. Second one, the foundation of territorial possession. Deuteronomy chapter 11, verses 22 down to 24, it says, if you carefully observe all of these commands I'm giving you to follow, number one, to love the Lord your God, two, to walk in all his ways, three, to hold fast to him, then the Lord will drive out all of these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations larger and stronger than yourself. Right? All those things that are bigger than you, God's promise to drive out. But there's a number four. Every place where you set your foot will be yours. Your territory will extend from the desert, right? From the desert, that's the Arabic desert south, to Lebanon in the north, from the Euphrates in the east, and to the Western Sea, which is the Mediterranean. Okay. God said, I'm going to give you a large parcel of land. And if you want that large parcel of land, there are four conditions. And the four conditions are, number one, you've got to love me intensely. Number two, you've got to obey my commands. Number three, you've got to trust me completely. That's the back here. Where is it? To hold fast to him. To hold fast means to trust him completely. And then number four, walk out the land. In faith, I told you the land I'm going to give you. He said, I've given it to you, but you must walk it out if you want it. Okay? In Genesis 18 to 21, the boundaries are even more clear. It says, on that day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants I will give this land. What land? From the river of Egypt, that's the Nile, folks, from the river of Egypt, that's in the southwest, to the great river, the Euphrates, that's the northeast. Now, interesting enough, well, I'll tell you about this in a second, to the land of the Canaanites, the Gerizzites, the whateverites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Raphaites, the Termites, all those ites, right? God's giving them all these ites lands, right? Now, interestingly enough, from the river of Egypt, where the Israelites were at one time in bondage. To where? To the Euphrates. At the southern part is a place called Ur of the Chaldees, where Adam was originally called out by God. So basically, everywhere where at one time the Israelites were ever in oppression, God says, right, I'm going to restore to you. He said, I'm going to give you all this land, okay? I'm going to give you all this land. So God wanted to give the Israelites this massive amount of land. There's a picture from the Euphrates to the Nile, to the desert in the south, to the great sea in the west, was all the land that God had promised to give them. Now, the problem is that according to history, the Israelites only walked out from Dan, the boundaries of Dan in the north, to what's it called here, Beersheba in the south. Even though God had promised them land, said, I guarantee you the land, I give you this land, four conditions, love me, obey me, trust me, and in faith walk out the land. But they only walked out this portion. Look at how much they could have had. Half of Iraq, two-thirds of Syria, all of Jordan, the north part of Arabia, a bit of Egypt. But what did they get? What did they walk out? Basically, the land they got now. And we can keep talking about how, but God's promised them this land. Yeah, but there was a condition. Walk it out. What has God promised you, but you've never walked it out? Right? You've never gone there and said, God, you've promised me this, and you walk it. Day after day, you say, God, this is the land you've promised to give me. Right? How much more could we have if we did those four things? Okay. What does that have to do with us today? God, when we prayer walk on our streets, when God tells us, go to the street and prayer walk it, you just don't go and say, oh, God bless them. You claim that street in the name of the Lord for the kingdom of God. God, this is your street. You know, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, but we have to declare that. God, this is your street. God, this is your school. I claim this school for you. This is your business. I claim this business. This is your movie theater. I claim you. I claim this movie theater for the kingdom of God. This is your government offices, because God, you set up all governments, but I claim these government offices for the kingdom of God. This is your hospital, but Lord, I claim this hospital for the kingdom of God. Right? Whenever God tells us that something is ours, we just don't sit home and watch reruns and wait till they come, right? Till we get it. We have to walk it out. Claim it for the kingdom of God. Where every place where you set your foot, it will be yours. Okay? Third one. This is going to be tricky for some. Well, it's not very much taught at all. So you'll discover. It's called the foundation of identificational repentance. And again, words I normally don't use, but I couldn't figure out another word. But identificational repentance. Genesis 2, verse 7, the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Okay? Dust of the ground literally means in the Hebrew, dirt out of the soil. Turn to someone and say, you're dirt. Okay? Because it's true. It's true. You're created out of the dirt. Fortunately, you have a spirit and a Holy Spirit within you, so you're nice dirt. Right? What did Paul say? You're a treasure in an earthen vessel. But we're made out of dirt, okay? We're made out of dirt. Adam was formed from the dirt out of the ground, and ever since that moment, because we're made from the ground, from the dirt in the ground, our spiritual life influences the ground. Our spiritual life influences the ground. Genesis 3, verse 17. To Adam, God said, because you ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. See, the Bible doesn't say that God cursed the ground. God did not curse the ground. God did not curse anything. Okay? Cursed is the ground, Adam, because you sinned. A curse came on you, and it affected the ground also. Okay? The ground from which Adam was made shared in the curse. Okay? When Cain killed his brother Abel, that sin affected the ground. Let's look at that. Genesis 4:10, the Lord said, what have you done to Cain? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from what? From the ground. Now you are under a curse, and you're driven from the ground. How can you be driven from the ground? Like everybody, we all walk on ground. None of us can fly. We don't levitate. We live on the ground. But no, God was saying, you're driven from this ground because you've put a curse on this ground because you killed your brother, and this ground doesn't want you anymore. There's a curse on it, and it doesn't want you here anymore because it doesn't want to suffer the evil that's in your heart. It doesn't want to suffer anymore, so it wants you gone. So Cain had to leave that region because of the curse that was put on the ground. Okay? There's a murder spirit in Cain. And the dirt says, I don't want this guy anymore. That's why the Bible says, Romans 8, 19 to 21, the creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed, that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay. Why is the creation in bondage to decay? Because the earth has been cursed because of our sin. Earth doesn't sin. We sin. The curse, the earth experiences the effects of our sin. Okay? Where am I? Okay, so creation, the earth, is in bondage because of us, because of the sins of Adam. And all of creation now is waiting for you and I to step up as the sons and daughters of God, to walk in righteousness, to have clean hearts before God, so that it can be liberated from bondage. The earth itself is one day going to be healed as we walk as sons and daughters of God. And that's why all around the world, wherever there's a movement in a country of national repentance of sin, if you've seen any of the transformation videos, whenever there's a movement of repentance of national sin, it is always accompanied by a transformation of the land. The crops get bigger, the fish get more abundant, the water gets purified. Isn't that amazing? Why does that happen? Because the curse is being taken off of the ground. In Fiji, they actually watched as poison water suddenly cleared right up. The water changed color when the leaders of Fiji repented before God, and the waters changed color. They were poisonous waters. They were no longer poisonous. Suddenly the fish, they'd not been able to catch any fish. The fish came back. The coral reefs became alive again. And they suddenly started getting vegetables, huge vegetables, off the land. Why? Because the curse came off of the land. A quick story. Try to make it quick. A number of years ago, Pastor Kathy and I were meeting in a restaurant on Tashro, the old Rio restaurant when it was on Tashro. And we're sitting there having, I guess it was a lunch on a Saturday or something. And we were praying and we're talking about the Lord. And there was this couple over a couple tables looking at us. And finally, they came over and sat down with us, right? Whatever. And it turns out they were First Nations people from Ganawagi. And we started talking. They said, "Are you Christians?" "Yes." And, "Oh, yeah, we're Christians." And we started talking. And anyway, for some reason, we started talking about St. Lambert. And when we talked about St. Lambert, they said, "Oh, my people aren't welcome there." I went, "Oh, what do you mean your people aren't welcome there?" And they said, "The land does not want us there." I said, "Really? Like, you got to explain that one." And what they said is, every time someone who's First Nations goes to St. Lambert and tries to buy a house, invariably within 2 or 3 days, stuff starts being knocked off shelves. There's banging all night long. They went to the kitchen. They found dishes being knocked against the doors, dishes flying out of the cabinets and falling on the floor. They said, "St. Lambert doesn't want us there." I go, "Well, that's kind of, you know, kind of weird." So that's all we knew about it. And I go, so I talked to a couple other First Nations. There is no First Nations person living in St. Lambert today, not even one. And I go, so I can't let that lie, right? So I was talking to a person that grew up in the area, and I said, and I told her this story, and she said, "Oh yeah, yeah, the St. Lambert massacre." And I go, "What?" She said, "Oh, yeah, yeah, St. Lambert Massacre." In the early 1800s, there was a Methodist minister, an evangelical, that was bringing a bunch of the Mohawks along the river to get to the reserve, and he had made a deal with the military, and it was a trap. And as they went through St. Lambert, they massacred the whole tribe. They killed the whole tribe. This is history, folks. From that point on, because of the curse that was put on the land in St. Lambert, the First Nations people cannot live in St. Lambert. The other thing is, there is not a single, even because the Methodists were evangelical, there is not a single evangelical church in St. Lambert. They're all liberal. There's not one evangelical church. And when I first did this study, I don't know about now, there was not even one evangelical small group meeting in St. Lambert, because the land didn't want them there because of the sin, right? Our sin affects the ground. if we want to see an evangelical church in St. Lambert, what we need to do is call the First Nations together and have a meeting in St. Lambert and publicly repent for the sins of that Methodist minister and repent before them and ask forgiveness, and hopefully they'll forgive us, and that will break the curse off the land. But to this day, there's still a curse in St. Lambert. See, that's how greatly our sin can affect the land. So why am I sharing all this? I'm sharing all this that if we do not repent of the sins in our community, you can pray till you're blue in the face and nothing's going to happen. You've got to repent for the sins. Now, again, you don't have to say, well, I did this, but that's what's called identificational repentance. In the Old Testament, so many times they said, Lord, on behalf of our nation, on behalf of our people, repent of, and they listed the sins. You know, so what does that mean? It means that whenever we prayer walk, before we even start prayer walking, like again, why is prayer walking not very effective? Because we don't do it God's way. The first thing we need to do is cleanse our own hearts of sin, so we don't just add to the pollution on the land as we prayer walk it. Like serious stuff, folks. If you're going to prayer walk our area, you need to have a cleansed heart first. Get right with God. Then we should ask forgiveness for what we've allowed on our land, whether it be prostitution, whether it be whatever, murder, whether it be selling of drugs in our parks especially. We need to first pray repentance for the drug traffic going on in most of our parks. Okay. All the known sins that we've allowed in our area, we need to repent of first before we prayer walk. Okay. And then as we prayer walk, we need to be open to God telling us additional information about our area that we need to repent of. We found out on our street, there were two grow ops on our street. Just two houses to the right, two houses to the left, they were both illegal marijuana grow ops. We had to pray repentance for what was being allowed on our street. Okay. So the third step, the third part of foundation of prayer walking is this thing about identification and repentance. We need to heal the land. The fourth thing is the foundation of spiritual warfare. Joshua 6, 2-4, then the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city. Ooh, march. In the Hebrew, that's the word walk. Oh, prayer walking. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. On the seventh day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. And when you have heard them sound a long blast on the trumpets, have all the people give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse and the people will go up, every man straight in. Okay, strange instructions, right? Really bizarre, strange instructions. Okay, just to let you know, folks, I've given you Jericho. It's yours. I've delivered them into your hands. However, if you want to see the manifestation of that, you have to march around the city six times once each day. And the seventh day, you have to pick up your trumpets, blow all the time you're marching, 7 times on the seventh day, and then you need to blow a loud blast and then a loud shout, and then I'm just going to knock over the walls and you can just walk right in. And that's exactly what happened. If you've ever been to the site where the Jericho used to exist, the archaeologists will tell you all the walls fell inward. None of it fell outward. They all fell inward. Okay. So what was going on? This is the spiritual warfare aspect of prayer walking. Okay, they were walking around the city. They were thanking God for the fact that God had given them the city as they're walking around the city. And the seventh day, they were supposed to blow the trumpets. Now, whenever trumpets were blown in the Bible, they either symbolized a call to assembling together, which they obviously were assembling together, or a march to war. When they blew the trumpets, it was a call to war. Okay. They were united in their commitment to take Jericho. They marched together as the nation of Israel. And they understood that this marching was actually spiritual warfare for God. Okay, God was calling them to the spiritual warfare. Then they were to give a loud or a long blast. A long blast of a trumpet always represented the moment of victory, right? Whenever there was a loud blast in the Bible, it always represented the moment of victory, right? It says in the last days there'll be a trump, the trumpet of the Lord will blow. It's the victorious sound, and then the dead of Christ will rise first, right? It's a moment of victory. And they were all then to give a loud shout together. Well, a loud shout in the Bible always symbolized a joyful celebration of victory. The shout wasn't warfare anymore. It was saying, God's given us the land. They shout together a loud shout, declaring the victory of what God had already done. Okay, that's what that was all about. So God was telling them that as they marched around the walls of Jericho, they were to declare that Jericho already belonged to them. God had given it to them. And they were to use their trumpets to symbolize the united call to warfare prayer, warfare prayer, ending with a shout of victorious celebration, okay? And this united warfare was immediately followed by the shout of victorious celebration, okay? Why were they to shout at the very end? Because it was the Lord that was doing the fighting for them. Remember, they didn't have to fight. The Lord was doing the fighting for them, but they had to give the shout of victory as really that trust. Remember that, to trust God completely. They say, yes, God, you're giving us the city now. Okay? And they were just declaring what God was doing and then celebrating the victory that God had given them. So another foundation of prayer walking is this foundation of spiritual warfare, that when we prayer walk, we are to thank God. Again, not just bless this house, but thank God for giving us the land that we're prayer walking, okay? We're to understand that we're doing spiritual warfare as we prayer walk. And we're to declare that God is breaking down strongholds, pulling down barriers, walls of resistance, and giving us victory over the area we're prayer walking, okay? So, how should we prayer walk? Number one, start with identificational repentance. Prayer, a cleansing prayer of repentance over your own life, so we don't add any defilement to the land. Then pray prayers of repentance for the things that we know are the evils in our area. If it's a school and there's a big drug problem, don't pray drugs if there isn't, but if there is, that's what you repent of. What you know, you repent of on behalf of the area, okay? Prayers of repentance for the things we know need forgiveness for. Unrighteous politicians, corrupt law enforcement, drug trafficking, sex trafficking. Anything we know that's not righteous, we need to repent of on behalf of the city or whatever the region is we're prayer walking around. And then we're open to additional insight from God of what needs repentance that you may not even know of. I remember once we were in a meeting, we were praying, all of a sudden God said we need to repent of the spirit of Pharaoh. And I went, okay, we repented. And I went to the guy after, he goes, what was that? And he goes, I don't know, God just told me we need to repent of that. It was a couple of years before we learned what the spirit of Pharaoh was all about. We don't have time to go into that today, but it's cool. Okay, it's also terrible in Quebec. I'll go into it. Okay, what did Pharaoh do? Pharaoh did basically two things. Number one, he kept God's people in bondage. What is one of the biggest problems in Quebec? God's people are in bondage, religious bondage, bondage of fear, other things, right? The second thing the spirit of Pharaoh did was tried to kill the next generation. We have the highest dropout rate of teenagers anywhere in North America, here in the province. We have a lot of drug abuse. And there's abortion, yes, definitely. Abortion is rampant here. All these things, that's spirit of Pharaoh. And there's specific ways to deal with the spirit of Pharaoh. That's another lesson, like I said. Second thing is inspired revelation. As we're walking, we say, God, what do you want me to pray over this street? What do you want me to pray over this school, this classroom, this house, whatever, this business, this church, this playground? God, what do you want me to pray over? And you ask God, and you pray according to the way God shows you. Again, don't go with an agenda, go with an open ear to God, right? Number three, how should we prayer walk spiritual warfare? Make sure we're in right relationship with the person we're walking with, right? It's a unity thing, right? Make sure the person you're walking with you actually like a bit, right? You know, hidden offenses against the person you're prayer walking with. So we can pray from a place of unity. Then we declare that strongholds would come down, because it is a spiritual warfare thing. And we thank God for the victory he's given us in the place we're prayer walking. And then fourth, territorial possession. We claim everywhere we walk for the kingdom of God. Declare that school, that playground, that place belongs to the kingdom of God, because it does. And pray for the drug traffickers and the sex traffickers and the pedophiles, the rapists, the stalkers, the gang members. They have to leave because this is God's ground. My friend, my son-in-law, Sammy Robinson, did that in a park out in B.C., and the very next day they caught the three biggest drug traffickers in the park. The very next day. Why don't you prayer walk? Okay. Prejudice, racism, all strife, leave in Jesus' name, whatever the issue is, right? For those places you're prayer walking, and you dedicate those places to God. Okay. How should we not pray? How should we not prayer walk? Number one, don't pray the problem. Oh, God, this is such a terrible place. I already knew that. God, there's so many problems in the city. I already knew that. Right? We can waste our time, our breath, by telling God all the problems. See, once you've told God all the problems, nothing's changed. We've actually just reinforced the problems. Instead, we pray the solution. We thank you, God, for touching hearts. Thank you, God, for opening hearts to the gospel. Thank you, God, for setting people free. Thank you, God, you know, and we pray the solution. Never pray the problem. And we don't have to tell God, because he already knows, right? He's already informed. He's the guy that's inspiring us, right? Number two, don't condemn, speak blessing. Oh, God, just judge those evildoers. No, God already knows there's evildoers there. Okay, instead we bless. God, we bless purity to come into that home. We bless righteousness to come. We bless that person with repentance. We bless that person with a spiritual awareness and awakening. All this is on the website if you want to download the notes, okay? We bless, we do not curse, according to Romans 12, verse 14, okay? And the third thing, don't get sidetracked, right? You're prayer walking through a mall, and then suddenly, oh, I feel led to buy that coat. No, you're there. You're there to prayer walk, okay? You don't get sidetracked on what you need to do when you're finished prayer walking. You don't get sidetracked on the sales in the mall. You don't get sidetracked by picking up the bat and playing a game of baseball with the kids. Wait till you're done your prayer walking, right? Stay focused on what you're there for. Interceding for your street, your neighborhood, your workplace, your school, your hospital, whatever it is. A few other quick tips about prayer walking. Pray with a partner. Why do you pray with a partner? It keeps you focused. When you're with somebody else, it keeps you focused. You're doing it together, right? Everything is established in two or three witnesses. How can two walk together unless they agree? So you're agreeing together, you're staying focused. Number two, pray out loud if possible. Again, it helps you to pray with clarity. When you pray in your mind, you sometimes have wandering thoughts. That's why when I read the Bible, I read the Word of God out loud. Even when I'm all by myself, I read the Bible out loud so my mind stays clear. I'm thinking about what I'm reading. If I just read it in my mind, then I'm suddenly thinking about supper or the fact I'm fasting or the fact that something. Anyway, okay. So pray aloud if possible. Pray with God's Spirit. Lord, lead me as I pray. What do you want me to pray? And you'll end up praying the weirdest things over the weirdest places. But that's okay, because God's got insight that you don't have. Okay. Number four, pray with God's word. Get some scriptures. Thank you, God, that everywhere I set my foot, you're giving to me. You can pray, you know, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Pray some scriptures over the place we're prayer walking. And take notes. Take a sheet of paper and a pencil, and as God gives you revelation, write it down so you can pray those things again later or the next time you prayer walk through that same place on other occasions. Because we're going to talk a lot about this next week. Be persistent. Almost always nothing happens after prayer walking one time. If you want to see change, you may have to prayer walk the same street a dozen times. Well, let's think about it for a minute. How many times did they prayer walk around Jericho? Seven plus six is 13. 13 times they prayer walked around Jericho, not just once. 13 times, and the 13th time the walls fell in. I can promise you that if you want to see some things change, you can't just prayer walk once. The results are minimal. But if you are persistent, you're going to see incredible changes. Okay, that's another reason our prayer walking usually is not very effective. We do it once and that's all. Mike and I have prayer walked the streets here, what, 5 or 6 times already? You know, just keep, and then suddenly someone says, oh, I live down the street, I just felt to come. We had a guy on Saturday. He said, I just suddenly felt led of the Lord to go online. I went online, I taped in some words, I found your church, I came to the men's breakfast, and here I am. Like, how did that happen? Well, we're prayer walking, and God is starting to change things, okay? Okay, summary. What is prayer walking? Prayer walking is praying on site with insight. That sounds good. I thought I'd throw it in. Prayer walking is on-site intercession. Or prayer walking is praying in the very places that we expect God to manifest his answers. If you want God to change the school, prayer walk in the school. If you want God to change your hospital, prayer walk in the hospital. If you want God to change your neighborhood, don't sit inside your house. Prayer walk your neighborhood. Prayer walking is in the very places that we expect God to manifest his answers. Okay. And all of these are very true. We need to do this. But as I said, your prayer walking must include the four foundations we just talked about. Identification or repentance. Repentance on behalf of the evil done in the place you're prayer walking. Inspired revelation. Seek God's insight on how to pray. I remember once we were prayer walking over this person's house, and suddenly it's like we're drawn to the garage for no, you know, and we went into the garage and there's all these boxes everywhere, and so we're drawn and we said, God, show us, and we're moving along through the garage, and we just really felt the Lord say, bend over, and then suddenly we felt this cold in this area. So there's a box there, and I go, what's in that box? And the lady said, I don't know, we moved here 2 years ago, we've never even looked in the box, I have no idea what's in the box. We looked up in the box and it was full of all of these occult paraphernalia. And she'd been having depression and all these other things. And she had this whole thing full of occult stuff. And she had no idea. But as your prayer walk, God will lead you to do certain things. I had another example of prayer walking, but it's escaped me. Just recently, I did another prayer walk in a home. Anyway, it's gone. I'm going to spend time on it. Well, yeah, well, that's another one. We were prayer walking through this other home. Suddenly I felt led to go to this closet. I felt that God just says, go to that closet, open up. Well, it was a closet. It wasn't voodoo, but was another thing where the spouse was using these things to put curses on people's lives, and he would open the closet, do these secret rituals, and close the closet again. Well, you know, you're prayer walking, and God leads you to the right place, and then you can take authority over it, right? So, inspired revelation, seek God's insight. Number 3, spiritual warfare. Recognize that when you're prayer walking, do some spiritual warfare. And number 4, territorial possession. Claim that territory for the kingdom of God. As I said, next Sunday, I'm going to give you examples of how through prayer walking homes, we've seen major transformation. Prayer walking in businesses, in office complex, prayer walking on streets, everywhere where we've seen, that's a terrible testimony, though. We prayer walked around this really seedy bar a bunch of times, and then after a number of times, the thing suddenly burnt to the ground. And I go, I felt bad because the guy was out of a job, but I thought, but this place was ruining marriages. This place was ruining people's lives because of what was going on in that place. You know, so we didn't get signs, you know, placards. We just prayer walked around it, and suddenly the thing strangely burnt to the ground, and like I said, I fell for the guy. God wants us to take our authority. He's given this amazing tool where we can change our families. We can change the atmosphere in our homes. You got strife in the home. Don't get into an argument with your spouse or your kids. Prayer walk around the home. We'll talk about that next week. If you're having trouble in the workplace, don't get arguing with your supervisors. Prayer walk around the floor. Right? If you're having trouble with a noisy neighbor, don't threaten him. Prayer walk around your neighborhood. Like, we'll talk about all this next week. I got lots of stories, okay? This Friday, as I said, what's that, 6 days from now? No, 5 days from now, next Friday at 6:50. Those that are available, we're going to meet down here in the parking lot, do a quick prayer here, and we're going to walk for a maximum of an hour. And we're just going to walk around these streets because we want to see God's kingdom come, especially this part. There's a lot of drug deals go down just down the street in the big park there that have to be dealt with. So we're going to send one team just to prayer walk that park for a while, right? But there are other places also. I even caught a guy doing a prostitution thing down there last summer. We have to deal with these things. And God's given us the tool to deal with them. It's called prayer walking. And as I said, next week, amazing stories about salvations and healings and deliverances and transformation just from prayer walking. Let's stand to our feet. Prayer walking is not just praying while walking. Prayer walking is changing, transforming the spiritual condition of wherever you do it. If you do it enough times and you use God's plan, not your own. Okay. Father, we just pray this afternoon. I hate to stop now, God, because I want to encourage people more. But Lord, I pray that we would step out in faith and become committed to prayer walking. God, if there's a place, maybe it's our own home that's full of strife. If so, Lord, I pray people would come next Sunday and learn how to transform the atmosphere in their home. Lord, if it's their place of business, I pray they'd come and learn how to transform that place where they work. God, wherever their school, God, they come and learn how to transform their school. Lord, for right now, just help us to be people that obey your word. Lord, what is it? What did you say? You said we have to love you, we have to obey you, we have to trust you fully, and we have to walk the area that you've told that it belongs to us. Help us to do that.